Welcome everyone, guests, family and friends. I'd like to welcome everyone to the service. Thank you for everyone's efforts, your support, your compassion, your caring, and of course your love. This room is filled with people, but it's also filled with just that. We appreciate everyone, no matter what they did to make this work, as we are here to honor, to cherish, to love, and to celebrate the life of Mike Starr. Thank you. In just a couple of minutes, I will invite Jim Hacker to come up. He'll be guiding us through the ceremony.
Welcome, everyone. On behalf of Mike's entire family, I want to thank everyone for coming today. Mike was born on April 4th, 1966 in Honolulu, Hawaii. When Mike's family settled in Seattle, Mike was 9 years old. I was the first person to meet him. A friend of mine who is here today, Paul Parkinson and I, we're walking from my house to Paul's house. And along the way, we noticed this lady up in her yard with her lawnmower, grass about knee high, trying to get her lawnmower started. She wasn't having any luck. So Paul and I decided to go up and give her a hand. Well, after a few minutes, Paul and I got this lawnmower started, and she was very grateful. And as we were leaving, she asked if we wanted to meet her son, Michael. So she went in the house and looked for Mike. Mike was nowhere to be found. She was yelling for Mike inside, outside, still no Mike. Well, Mike, he must have heard his mom calling for him. He was in the backyard. So he made his way down alongside the side of the house, into the front yard, and announced his presence to us. Mike was on stilts. At 9 years old, Mike Starr was already bigger than life. We all quickly became very good friends. We would hang out at Mike's house every day after school, on the weekends. Mike's place was the hangout pad. We would watch old Bruce Lee movies, practice our karate on each other, and listen to music. A lot of music. We listened to Jimi Hendrix, Van Halen, Mike would often say, "Man, Hacker, when I grow up, I'm gonna be a rock star just like them." It was never a pilot, astronaut, doctor. Mike knew what he wanted to be. There was never a doubt in his mind. He was gonna be a rock star, plain and simple. In fact, in Mike's senior memories book at Highline High School, he wrote, and I quote, "I'm gonna be a rock star and tour with Van Halen." Well, guess what? He did it. He did that and a lot more. One of Mike's greatest attributes, and he had many, was his undying love for friends and family. One of those friends I would like to come up and share now is Mike Jordan. Mike?
Hello, I'm Michael Jordan. You know, I hope I don't look much different than that now. Some of you have been lying to me this afternoon, telling me that I don't look much different, so I'll take that to heart. Bear with me, this is a little bit difficult. I've done a lot of public speaking, done some TV, some radio. I don't think I've ever had to eulogize a guy who was one of my best friends growing up and who's really like a brother. I actually went through about 4 drafts, and I thought, you know, I'll just come up and read. Sometimes it's good to have a script. So I'll ask for your patience, because I trashed all those drafts. I just couldn't quite get it down on paper. And the pages got tear-stained, and yeah. Anyways, Mike and I first met in the 7th grade at Puget Sound Junior High, and we became fast friends. But at 7th grade, you know, you're still finding yourself. You're still developing psychologically. You just want to be liked. You just want to be considered cool by people and just try to get through the day. And I think all of us that can think back that far and have those memories intact and would agree. You know, you just want to get through your day and be liked. And we were friends. And then I went to a different school. And then when Mike came over to Highline High, we became like brothers, nearly inseparable. Mike used to like to say, "Hey, if you know Mike Jordan, you know Mike Starr." And that, for those of you that knew him back then, I hope that little imitation rings true. It's funny, I used to mimic him, and he'd just laugh. And Mike was a funny guy, which if you knew him later in life, I'm not sure if he had that, because Mike and I grew apart after the Alice in Chains years. You know, we kept in contact by phone, tried to get down to L.A. to see him. Some would always come up, but we always kept in contact by phone. And like Jimmy said, Mike loved his family and friends, and he always held them close, and he always would recall memories. And his powers of recall were, well, they were amazing, frankly. I'd be like, dude, I don't remember that girl. How is it that you do? She was my girlfriend, right? How do you remember? Well, I won't blather on too much as I stumble over this and try to keep from turning into a total freaking mess up here. But Mike was always, and always ended up looking out for him. As our relationship grew into our teen years, you know, those roles become defined. And my role started to take on a little bit of a protector role, somebody who would facilitate being able to party along with him, kind of keep him safe. The last time that I spoke to Mike on the phone, it was the same old, "Hey man, I'm doing great, I'm doing good, been clean, life's good, I'm playing music," which of course he always loved. And he was in a good spot the last time that I had an exchange with him and talked to him. The same old, "Let's get together soon, hope your life's great, love you brother." And he and I would always say that, and it's not uncommon. There seems to be a bond among the people that grew up in Burien from back in that day that went to Puget Sound Junior High. Right, Dorothy? You always kind of drop in, "Hey, I love you. If I don't see you in a while, I love you." And Mike always made sure to tell his friends that. And certainly told his family that. But I would get that call, "Hey, I'm thinking about you. I love you. All right, I'll talk to you later." I miss my friend. I wish I could have been there too. You know, look out for him and protect him like I did for so many years. You know, and it's funny, I knew this would happen despite all the years of speaking experience, that there's so much more that I wanted to say to you today, but there's a number of people that want to come up and talk, so I'll end my comments with, you know, I love that guy. He was like a brother to me. Our memories. I don't remember that hat, by the way. Gail, did you find that picture? It's like a giant psilocybin mushroom or something, right, Brock? Yeah, I might have borrowed it from Brock. You know, again, I'll ask for forgiveness. There's just so much more going on. And like I said, I knew Mike in his formative years when he was, you know, Mike Starr, going to be a rock star someday. He was that guy. And I knew him through the early years of Alice in Chains. I got to hang out with Jerry and Lane and those guys. We came out on the road a couple of times and got to hang out, and I was there to see Mike realize his dream of making it big in the music industry, and that'll always be something I cherish. It was always a blessing to be along for the ride for a couple of dates on a tour stop, and the guys in the band treated me like I was one of them, and it was really cool, and maybe in some way I was, because Mike and I were brothers. At the end of the day, really that's all you can hope for, is that people remember you well. In final analysis, I'll always have those memories of Mike, and I'll always keep them right here. Peace.
Very well said, Mike. We're going to switch it up a little bit. We're going to have three people come up and kind of speak at the same time. Dave Jensen, Terry Hildebrand, and Ken Kramer to come up, please.
Like Jim and Paul, I met Mike way back. You know, we were 9 years old. Check this out. This is great right here. Boulevard Park Elementary School, the Bulldogs. Anybody from Berrien? Fall 1975, Mr. Calloway's class in fourth grade. And I'm like, but then there's this knock on the door, and the whole class is sitting there like you guys are, and in strolls this kid. I swear, man, talking, Mike came in just like the stilts when Jimmy met him. You got that picture up here, it's like fourth, I mean, he's got this hat on, he's just all about, he's got so much style going on that it was amazing. And I thought, wow, this guy, I mean, Gail, I mean, you dressed him appropriately. To really, I mean, it was hip, it was cool. I just was going, whoa, I want to know, you know, who's this friend? Sixth grade camp right there, Camp Waskowitz. We had a great teacher that year. What are we, like 11? Right there, maybe 11 years old. And I got that sideways look thing going already. Yeah, Mike doesn't quite have a mustache yet, though, there. I think that came when we hit Puget Sound. Yeah. And I never got one. So sixth grade class, it was a blast. Mike was always fun, just like Jim was saying, man. He did things way outside the box. I don't think he ever thought inside the box. It was just always, hey, what can we do here? Let's do this there, you know. It was fun. He's always fun to be around. The other memories I have that are fun from junior high school, like what Mike Jordan said, is I remember having guitar class. Was really fun. It's indelible memories of Mike. When he walked into fourth grade, sixth grade class just burned into my memories. I mean, guitar class in eighth and ninth grade at Puget Sound Junior High, great time. And then I kind of went off in a different direction when we went to high school and started working, playing drums in a working band. And then Mike continued on and started getting more into, you know, this rock bass playing and stuff. It was awesome, man. And a funny story there is, you know, we always stayed friends. I was in another band, you know, working, doing top 40 cover music in this high school band, playing on weekends. And so from then the Sato thing started happening. So from there, I'm just going to turn this over right here to Terry and Ken, because they kind of really have a little bit more of the details on that stuff with him. And
What's with the Corvette? What's with the Corvette above your snare? Was that your motivation?
That was it. That's all I had. You know, I remember.
I totally forgot about that.
Do you guys remember Art Ford saying, "You're going to be easy. All you want is a car." Yeah. You know.
Sweet.
Look at that, man. The Rickenbacker. So I'm going to turn it over to Terry and Ken here.
You want me to have that? Okay.
Mike was the most outgoing person I've ever met in my life. Like literally, Mike could walk up to anybody, anywhere, anytime and start a conversation. When I graduated, I went to Kennedy. A lot of good it did, huh? And my dad's got hair there. Well, so do I. So cherish that photo. Mike's got his Black Sabbath t-shirt on. That's awesome. So I graduated, and my dad took us to Hawaii. The drinking age was still 18 back then. And me and Mike would just trip around, you know, walking up and down the beach. And Mike could literally, anybody, he could walk up and start a conversation. Well, especially a blonde in a blue bikini. I like, look at him sucking it in. I love that shot. And the cutoff shorts, that's awesome. But he could start a conversation with anybody, and that person would just be loving him immediately. Anybody recognize the license plate for Mike's car? Huh? So we pulled that off for a really awesome photo shoot that we did. But I believe that, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this was probably the first Sato gig. And Mike and I was playing in a band with some guys at Kennedy. That's where the drummer Darren Garrett came from. And Mike's playing my dad's bass there. We hadn't quite got into the black and white stripes thing yet, but it was coming. And anyways, Mike and I kind of started it, you know, and we spent a ton of time in his room, just doing everything, making flyers. And it's a little hard to read, but I got to give John credit for the don't say no, say toe. That's his line. So John Starr, that's John's line right there. But, you know, I mainly remember a lot of hanging out in his room. Nice. Wow. Maybe we should have done a Clearasil commercial there or something. I have no idea what Mike is saying to me right there. I think that's one of those good, we should pass that around and people could just fill in the quote like, hey, dude, check out that chick in the front or whatever. But, you know, we spent a lot of time in Mike's room jamming. Mike's room was like the most amazing place. I never seen anybody decorate their bedroom like Mike did. It was like a wonderland, and you'd hang out in there. I mean, the only thing I didn't like about Mike's room was that goddamn tarantula. I didn't like that thing. And then somebody stepped on it. Well, fine. I really can't explain to you. I can't explain where this came from. I don't know. I would like to blame somebody, but I have nobody else to blame for it. Yeah, Jeff's not here, so we'll blame it all on Jeff.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, can we just talk about Capizios? With duct tape on the sole, that was a must. Leg warmers, a scarf, a unitard, spandex. I was gonna have Nels Photoshop in the crotch a little more there, but you know, we ran out of time. But wow, that was just, it's embarrassing, but we're proud to share it with you because it was a great time in our lives, you know. And I mean, this is a classic, you know, Mike, the mustache era, I guess you got to call it, you know. You know, Sato kind of, we did the Battle of the Bands, we did the Northwest Metals Fest record, and you know, we had maybe, you know, a little bit of success, nothing great, but you kind of got that taste for where Mike was headed, you know. And after Sato kind of came to an end, I didn't see him a whole lot, but he would always stay in touch. And that's just like Mike was saying, you know, Mike, if you were Mike's friend, he'd always let you know.
Yeah, that's how Mike did it. He'd swung by your parents' house if he couldn't find you and leave you a note, or you know, tell your mom to call me, buddy. I got a little bit different perspective just because I'm a little bit older. I just remember him as an unconditionally loving person. You know, it didn't matter any of you guys, whoever you were, if you knew him, he loved you unconditional no matter what. And that's how I felt about him. And that's one of the things I wanted to say. I know he loved his family and all you guys unconditionally. We were, Danny and Dave and I were jamming in Danny and Dave's mom's garage, a couple blocks away from where Gail lived. And this kid would constantly come down the road and hang out, sit outside, and, you know, I play bass. You know, I can play. I'm going to be a rock star someday. And, you know, after 2 or 3 months of that, I actually bought into it because he was so confident. And there's one thing about Mike, you know, that all you know is that he just brimmed with confidence. Mike was a little brother and a friend, a bandmate, you know, a great son, I think, a great brother. I have some stories. I spent a little bit more time with Mike after the Sado, between the Chains, Alice in Chains era, when you guys were, you know, living in the apartment and renting and, you know, that whole thing. And I got to share that with him a little bit. And one thing he told me, I went to a rehearsal with him. You guys were rehearsing under the bridge at Ballard. You remember that place? And I wasn't allowed to stay for the rehearsal. Jerry says closed rehearsal, so I had to go out and hang out with Tommy Gunn in the parking lot, I think. And I don't think Tommy wasn't allowed at that time either. But, you know, I waited and we hung out, and when Mike came out of that rehearsal, he walked up to me and he said, "You know what? Jerry's a genius. And Sean and Lane are amazing, and we're gonna be rock stars." So this was the transition right here. Mike went from Sado, and I think he transitioned into Gypsy Rose, yeah. And the Gypsy Rose was the transition to Alice in Chains, for which was not Alice in Chains, Diamond Lie, right. And I think then they got a hold of Lane and then changed it to Chains. So I did spend some time with these guys at that time, and then once they hit, he was gone, you know. It was like a rocket. You guys took off and you were doing your thing. But what was interesting about Mike, and like Terry said, is that he kept in touch. And one night I was at home doing my thing, and I got a phone call, and it was Mike. And he said, "Dude, I can't talk very long. I have this girl's cell phone, and I'm in the bathroom, and we're about to open for Van Halen, but man, I love you so much. I wanted to call you. I want you to be here. This is so great. And, you know, I wanted to share it with you, and I'm going to try to call everybody I know before she finds me." So anyway, he kept in touch with us, and I talked to him during the celebrity rehab thing. He called me, you know, and I held out hope for him in that regard, and unfortunately, it didn't work out, but great guy, loving unconditionally. One of the other things that we wanted to talk about, when you're in a band like Sado, it's not 400 million fans like Chains. If we had 40, a lot of you are here. So it wasn't an experience that is like, we all did it together. It's like a family. We went through all the agony and all this. So there's not a lot of stories I can tell you because you were there. You were probably there. That might be one of you right there, the back of your head. But we did have some Sado moms. And when you have a small, when you're on a soccer team and you're a kid, you got moms. And we had Sado moms. And Gail was a Sado mom. She always opened up her home and let us jam there and pretty much gave us free reign. Terry remembers eating top ramen. No, macaroni and cheese.
Kraft macaroni and cheese, for the record.
Kraft macaroni and cheese. And Melinda and John also were, you know, part of that experience. I don't want to be the drunk brother-in-law here at the wedding and ramble on, but visiting mom at work. See, this guy was amazing. Marlene made all of our, that's Terry's mom, she's here, she made all of our outfits. So Terry was wondering who to blame earlier. I don't want to blame Marlene because they were amazing. But at the same time, you know, and I don't want to make light of the situation. You know, Mike's passed and that's huge and that hurts. But, you know, he was funny. And we want to have fun too. So anyway, I think that's all we have. from our perspective.
You know, Mike loved to pick up the phone in the middle of the night and call. I was talking with Brooke Bangart, and she slept with her phone because she knew at any time during the middle of the night, she could get a call from Mike. I can't tell you how many times in the middle of the night, Mike would pick up the phone and call his friends. He just wanted to share all of the good times he was having with the people that he loved. The next guest speaker is a great friend of Mike's, Mr. Aaron Woodruff. Aaron?
Well, I know Mike about 27 years. I think the reason I met him at first was kind of wanted to meet his sister. A lot of good times with Mike. A lot of years went by. Didn't, lost touch with him briefly, but I always somehow ran into him or kept in touch. Got a chance to see a little bit of him when the guys were over in Germany, and that was an experience I'll never forget. It was pretty neat, and Mike, allowed me to, shared that with me, and as our friendship was, it was more to it, and we were connected in a way. He was a brother, I love his family, Gail, John, Melinda. It's a really hard thing. I'm really happy that there's been a lot of positive come out of this, a lot of reunions here. Seen a lot of people I haven't seen in a long time. And, when you lose someone close, it makes you appreciate life, a little more, and it is short. I think Mike's in a better place, but I know he's in a better place. Just wanted to end with a little something. I just opened last night I opened the Bible, though, but I rewrote this, and I just opened a page, and bam, something was, it's the first thing I looked at. I just want to share that, and that'll be done. But, there's a time for everything and a season for everything under heaven. Time to be born, time to die, time to plant, time to uproot, time to tear down, time to build, time to weep, time to laugh, time to mourn, time to dance, time to embrace, time to refrain. Time to search, time to give up, time to be silent, and time to speak. Time for war, and time for peace. Mike's at peace. Whatever is, has already been, what will be, has been before. God will call upon his children home. Thank you.
I thought I had a busy schedule, and I thought I was into a lot of things. Nothing compared to this guy. It's Melinda's fiance, Chris. He's absolutely one of the most amazing people I've ever met. Chris?
I first met Mike a few months before Facelift was released at a club called English Acid, where both our bands played. That night, I made a friend who, like Mike, would play an important role in my life and be my real introduction to Mike. And his name was Lane, and we remained friends for the next several years, where I got to know Mike a little. And after Hollywood's Dark Side chewed me up a little bit, I went back home, cleaned up, got a job, cut my hair, it sucked. And I went back to Hollywood and got a job at the Palace. And on the way home from work, who do I run into is a good old Mike Starr. I met his idol, his best friend, his father, John. I found it touching that they loved each other so much they could have such a close friendship. But the craziest thing was my neighbor next door was an old friend of mine, Rodney, and his girlfriend, Melinda Starr. Weird, huh? Now, 18 years later, I call Melinda my soulmate and the love of my life. I call Mike my brother, my family, and like bros. We went through a lot together these past 2 years, but most important are these last few months and the unexplainable transformation into the Mikey I first met 20 years ago, showing a face smiling and shining, unknowingly ready to ascend into the arms of his waiting friends. I'm sure a lot of you knew Mike in his childhood and then into his adulthood, where he went from a kid with a rock and roll dream to the kid living that rock and roll dream, way bigger than he could have ever imagined. He wasn't just some local kid who made it into the rock world. He was one quarter of a group that was going to change the face of the music for the entire planet forever and set him on a path so dark, if not for the glow that lit his heart of fire. I don't see any other way he could have made it. 18 years with a shattered spirit, when after circumstances unknown to, and to be honest, none of anybody's business but those directly involved, he played his last show and then went his way. And I believe nobody knew Mike would really end up getting so lost on his way back, and that it would take him 18 years to find his way home. I could talk for hours about all the suffering I've seen Mike wade through, but anybody who knew Mike knew he suffered. But I'm gonna share my story from when I picked Mike up a few days after Christmas this year. And when I saw him, he was smiling from ear to ear, talking and laughing the whole way home. And when we got to our place, Melly and my place, we all ate, watched Hellboy 2. Mike was happy in a way I hadn't seen since, you know, before Argyle. We all slept like babies in the bed, Mel in the middle so Mike couldn't spoon me while I was sleeping. Mike in a short time, and he did. He'd spend the night and I'd wake up and he'd be cuddling me. And I was like, you're lucky we're family. But in a short time he was making plans for his new band and moved to Utah with his friend and singer, Travis. And due to Mike's admiration for Travis, and they finally got to unite. And that brought Mike true joy, not just a gift for Mike, but for all lucky enough to be close enough to him, and especially those who got to spend time with him in these last few months. Sober or not, he was staying in the light, happy, avoiding the darkness. He knew too well before Utah, we spent a good amount of time together, watched a lot of Alice in Chains videos, Mother Love Bone videos, and then every single Alice in Chains video there is. And he loved everybody so much. Always, he just spoke so highly. He loved the music, and that was it, you know. And when he went to Utah, I hadn't talked to him for the first couple weeks because he made me mad, go figure, about something stupid, can't even remember. But I called him on the third and told him I'm sorry for not calling back till now. And he just told me he loved me and how much he enjoyed his new band and was ready to tour. I told him the new song from my band he liked, he was gonna jump up and play with us, and he was all happy and asked me for my band to tour with his. My last couple months with Mikey were surreal, a true blessing. And to top it off, he left me a message on my phone on the 7th. His words were warm, articulate, generous, and genuine. His last, very last words to me were, "You're my real brother. I love you. We're brothers for life." And Mikey wasn't as my brother. And his last gift of beautiful words will forever be in my heart and soul. Aside from Mel, will be the most prized possession for my brother before he went to meet his destiny, and he went into the arms of Andy and Lane's, or went into Andy and Lane's waiting arms.
Hi everyone, my name is David Lofton. And I'll try not to cry. Now let me say this, most of us here just know him as Mike. Yeah. He was born a star. When there was a kid that didn't have food, what would Mike do, Jim? He'd give him his lunch, the lunch that Gail packed for him that day. Mike lived life just like all of us do. And today I just want to say goodbye. Just want to tell Mike I love him. Love his mom and his dad. I love his sister, and I love this guy who I haven't met, who's with Melinda. So nice to see everybody here that cares for Mike. And I'm sure you all have an experience inside of you. And if you pull it out, you'll remember the smiles and the genuine love, because Mike never faked it. He just loved everybody. Yeah, Trace? Yeah, the genuine love Mike had for everybody in this room. And please, you know, remember all those good experiences, you know, those wonderful times. Forever. Thanks for the time up here.
Wow. God, looking at all those pictures is amazing. And it made me think about the first time I met him, which was in Burien, I guess. And my mother and grandmother had just passed, and I didn't really have anywhere to go. And I'd met this guy, Tim Branham, and he had invited me to come to his house and actually stay for a couple of days. And I was kind of camped out in his basement. And he said this guy was coming over to play bass with us to try out for Gypsy Rose, I guess. And Mike cruises up on a motorcycle, and he just looked really cool, man. And he was a great guy. And we got to spend about a week together. And I didn't make the band, actually. Rock did. And I got cut. And I think Mike lasted a little longer than I did. But I met Lane recently, or very very shortly after that. And he introduced me to Sean. And we were talking about maybe getting together and jam. And he's like, you got any ideas for bass players? And I'm like, you know, I met this guy, Mike Starr. It was really, really cool. He's like, that's really weird because he's my friend and I'm dating his sister. And I think I can make that happen, you know? So he brought him down, and, you know, that's how everything started for us. And you know, I'm just thinking about all the good stuff, and there was a lot of it. And we created some really, really amazing music together, and that will always kind of continue to live. We're in the process of playing that and still living that, and that part is always alive. And Mike was a big part of that. And we were a bunch of rat kids, man, and we kind of bonded together, and we lived under a wharf at the Music Bank, and we ran keys. Lane and I ran keys for TV dinners, and Mike and Sean and I, man, we'd go to 7-Elevens at like 4 o'clock in the morning to get like the old dried up food and to eat, and we relied on each other, and we were a family. Gail gave us a place to live. You know, we lived in that house for a long time, and you know, John lived with us for a while, and Mel was a part of the family, and he was a good man. He had a good soul. He had a big heart, and I heard a very good friend of mine who's not here anymore say that the best that we can hope for is to be human. And Mike most certainly was that. He was my friend, and I love him, and I'll miss him. Thank you.
Hi, I'm just sneaking in because I was Mike's good friend for several years, and I spent a lot of time with him, and the best times of my life I spent with Mike Starr. I just want y'all to know that he was the greatest guy I ever met. He was my best friend ever, and man, I miss
him. Last time I saw Mike, I told him that I would never give up on him, even if I was standing over his grave. And yesterday marks 21 years, 16 hours since, well, you guys know. But anyways, the people that were there for me for that were Jerry, Mike. You guys made all of that a lot better for me. So, okay, I'm fumbling now, but we don't say goodbye to Mike. We say hello. Say hello to heaven.
I met Mike when I was 16. Me and my best friend Renee here had an apartment. I don't know, I remember when we met him, he was driving his Fiat down on Elk High, and he's like, I want to party with you, you know? I always used to tell him, you guys are going to make it, you know? I know you guys are going to make it, and you're going to forget all about us, you know? And he did, but he never forgot about us. He just was, you know, living his dream, but we got back in touch again, and I got close with him and John, but anyway, I just wanted to say that I'm really gonna miss him, and thanks.
I just had to say something. My name's Tony. I met Mike when I was a kid,
in L.A., and I really looked up to him, man, you know. I met him after Alice, and he knew what an Andy Wood freak I was, and he would show me all his signed shit, and I would drool over it, you know. And we met through this dominatrix chick that we both knew. And we used to gauge our... We had a friend who walked around L.A. with a candle on his head, man. And so me and Mike would be like, well, we don't have a candle on our head, so we're good. You know, we can't be that high, you know. And we'd seriously gauge ourselves by that. Like, okay, we're not painting our face today. We're not putting a candle on our head. We're not walking around with a guitar in Hollywood for days on end. And what's funny was a year later, the Chili Peppers came out with this video with fucking fire on their helmets. Like, and we were laughing, like we knew where they got that from. But Mike was the greatest guy. We always stayed in touch. I have so many funny, ridiculous stories. You know, I used to have to check him sometimes on his ego, but then I'd have to lift him up too and be like, dude, Google yourself, man. You're a rock star, bro. I'm like, just hit the Google pics and you'll see, you know, what the hell, you know, you're a great guy and you're so beautiful. And I loved him like a brother, man. And we should salute him because he came to fucking rock and that's what he did. And I'm sorry about the cussing, but I'm a kid, man, that me and Mike, we're all about the rock. We're all about the rock, man, still, you know, and he did it. And I salute him and I'm proud that he was my friend and I'm proud of his accomplishments, you know. And he had the biggest heart, you know, and the dis-ease was way bigger than the heart, man, and that sucks. And it took our friend, but you know what? Well, we will see him again, man. So, Mike, I love you, dude.
Our next guest speaker was very close to Mike. Her name is Brooke Bangart. Brooke?
So, I also grew up with Mike. Mike actually says I went to the dark side because when I turned 13, I moved to Bellevue. I had some really good times with him. I flew in and picked him up, and then Melinda met us partway, and we were able to stay in a hotel in San Diego and talked about old times. And so I'm up at the counter at the hotel and I hear this Lionel Richie song playing Hello from behind. And I kind of closed my eyes and I was like, oh, I know that's him. We're gonna get kicked out of here for sure. We just got here. And all these people were running over saying, oh, sir, you can't play that piano. And he's like, well, why not? There's nobody playing. There are so many great stories, and he did make everyone laugh, whether he meant to or not. He was just a natural comedian, you know. And like everyone says, he loved his friends, and he loved his family. And he always asked me to make sure whatever happened that I took care of Melinda. And of course I would. We've been friends since we were so young. But he was always worried about Melinda. He loved his mom and his father. He's resting peacefully now. And that's the most important thing. That we can just let him go to where he needs to be. Thank you.
When I was up here at the beginning, telling my story of how I met Mike, I spoke about Paul Parkinson. Paul was an extremely important part of Mike's life, and up here speaking for Paul to share a little bit with you guys is his brother Marty.
Hi, my name is Marty Parkinson. Paul is my brother, my older brother. I'm going to share some memories that we had with Mike going way back as far back as his first bass guitar. Mike and I, our birthdays were very close together. And I can recall the day that I believe he got his first bass guitar, and him and my brother would be practicing. Of course, they were very terrible to begin with. Couldn't play a lick, but they jammed together, and there was a picture of my brother and Mike up there. They played a lot, and eventually got another guy by the name of Frank Roberts. They would end up jamming in my parents' rec room as loud as can be, and for some reason my parents put up with that. I don't understand why. But Mike eventually, you know, he said, he's already got the name, he's gonna be a rock star. And he did it. And that was one of the nicest things about Mike is that even though he was a big rock star, he would call me up from time to time from various locations around the country. And just to say, you know, that how much Paul meant to him. I've got tons of stories that I could share. Gail was a very gracious host. A lot of times when we were, my first memory is a snowball fight we had out in front of her house on 24th Avenue. Dave mentioned that Mike wasn't a fighter. We threw snowballs at a car. The car stopped. A guy got out. Most of us ran, but my brother went up there, being my brother that he was, taking care of me, beat the living daylights out of the guy. The guy abandons his car and leaves it there in front of the star's house. And of course, the gracious of Gail, she invited us around back. We couldn't go through the front yard or through the front door, but we had to go through the backyard, and she gave us hot cocoa. Mike had a huge heart. He was always a nice guy. He would come around from time to time. I didn't see him a whole lot, but when he was with Alice in Chains, he showed up at my doorstep one day out of the blue, and he just wanted to drive around in his car and talk. And that was all he wanted to do. Me and him didn't talk about his struggles. We didn't talk about his fame. We didn't talk about his success. It was just me talking with Mike. And that's all he wanted to do. And he always remembered. And, you know, like Brooke said, you know, you always would get that call. You can never know when you get that call. I received several calls from him in the middle of the night here. And he would talk about his success and how he loved life and enjoyed being a friend of ours. And that's all I have. Thanks. We'll miss you, Mike.
I'm Mark. Friends call me Harry. I met Mike when Alice in Chains came to L.A. years ago. Saw him around a little bit in L.A. And then I remember I came up to Seattle in 94, 95. And I was with a band, had a couple days off, and I was at the Vogue. Is that the place? Yeah. And I was like, oh my God, there's Melinda. She is the hottest girl in combat boots you'll ever see. I said, how's Mike? You know, he's here, he's in town. And I was like, okay. So I ended up going back to the house, and Mike was there. He was so proud. He got a new car. And dude, check it out. And I thought he was gonna take me for a ride in it, right? He got in a car by himself and drove around the block. He came back, pulled up, and I'm like, wow, that's a great car, buddy. You know, it's awesome. And we hung out in the basement. Like, this is the same basement I hear everybody talk about. There was a quality of him that was so. Yeah, I heard a lot of stories tonight about his childhood, and people have known him that long, and I wish I was around that long ago in Seattle to witness that. But I can honestly say I think I did, you know, in his adulthood. He was the happy kid who didn't want to be the pissed off adult. He ended up living with me at one point in L.A., and talk about spontaneity. I go into my room, and Mike walks out of my bathroom wearing all my clothes. Dude, what are you doing? He goes, yo, what do you think? Halloween, I'm gonna be you, Harry. Just like some of you today who spoke to him recently, he said, Harry, I'll always love you. You'll always be my brother. And though he may have shared that word brother to several people, you knew what that meant and how it applied to you specifically. I know exactly what he meant. He had an honesty about him that a lot of people lose throughout success. And man, he had no problem telling you how he felt. Nobody. I've never met anybody like Mike. You know? And when he was humble, when he wasn't proud, or when he was both, he was one of the most beautiful guys you'd ever meet. The lunch story, that's perfect. I've seen him give $100 bills to people, like starving guitar players who showed up for their shows and didn't know if they'd have enough gas to get home. I've seen him whip out a Ben Franklin and say, hey dude, get something to eat. I love the guy and I'll miss him. I won't be able to be woken up at 5 a.m. with Number of the Beast blaring anymore. Now he's with some really, really beautiful people, you know? Not that you're not, just saying. He's in a place now where he doesn't have to feel everything he felt here, you know? He gets to embrace whatever he wants without any setbacks, you know? That's awesome. Thank you. I'm tired. I'm gonna go cry by the food now. Thanks.
I've been like a wreck, you know, since this happened. And actually today I really don't feel as bad. I just think it's really nice that so many people love my brother and came to show it and share it. And I just think it's funny, I'm adorable and awesome that he has all these brothers, you know, because he really did. Like, if you were his friend, you were his brother, you know. But he was my brother. I really just feel really lucky. And, like, I just feel really lucky to have had the coolest brother anyone could ever have. That's what he was. So thank you all for sharing his life with him and, you know, being good to him and letting him be good to you. And he loves you all. Thanks.
For all the stories that you've heard today, there are 100 more for each one. And I know that you truly love this man. He was so sweet-hearted when he was good. When he was good, he was very, very good. I know the pain of losing your child. And the one thing that's missing in my life, because he was gone so much, he was with Mike and they were gone. They were all over the world. They were in different time zones. They could afford cell phones and most of us couldn't in the beginning. And we missed the years when they would have liked to have had families and live in Ballard and get together for holidays with all of us. And the one thing that's missing in my life is that from friends and family of Mike, and for those who say he was our brother and we were family, write your stories down. Put them in an email, phone, and share them, because from age 20 or so on, we really didn't have our sons. And those stories would mean so much to us, it would be the greatest gift in the world. Mike, that was the most valiant fight that anyone could have put up. The last few years of his life were incredible. And he was in and out of treatment, so most of those last few years he was sober and on his way to knowing more about a healthy life and a happy life. And the last time I spoke with Mike was just about 10 days before he passed away. I called Gail right away and I said, I just had the most wonderful phone call with Mike. I really know he's turned the corner. He wasn't obsessing on old stuff. He was really positive and happy. And I know that he was one rung higher in his ladder to heaven. And we'll just send him on his way with a lot of love. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Mike had unbelievable conscious contact with his higher power, which was a superstar. I like Mike. I mean, I love Mike and his actions for being famous. But beyond all measures, the man was a great spirit. Mike had so much love and compassion that he could send it to the whole world. I'll miss Mike a lot. He had a driving force called confidence. Once Mike stepped on a stage, the world became Mike Stars. But Mike was an individual and a friend since the day I was born. He was a true brother. Melinda was a true sister. I just wanted to tell everyone that didn't make it that Mike Star will be there every night, every day of your life if you've ever met him. Most insurance that he's ever had was that he was faithful to himself, but he had so much of God's love in him. He's the hardest worker I've ever met. One of the people that I've worked for a long time said, if you worked as John Starr, if you've ever worked for Mike, you know how hard a job Mike will do for you. Anyway, the way that Mike sold America was with music and love. I just want to let everyone know that he'll always be loved in my heart and never missed. Every day, the parents that taught us to go to school and grew up with us were our best friends. Thank you.
My name is Tim, and I met Mike when he was about 16. I hope I can get through this, but I heard that Sato was breaking up, and actually you guys kind of downplayed Sato because Sato was a really big band. It really was. I went over to his apartment in Burien, and first I missed him, and they're all driving back to, I think it was Skipper's, the whole gang, you know, you just saw all this massive cars driving back and forth. We finally found him. He went back to the apartment. His dad calls, and it was just like he was talking to his best friend. Then all of a sudden, we see this girl come down, you know, and we say, who is this hot chick? And well, it was Melinda, and she's only 13 years old. We said, how can this girl be so young? But he was really proud of his family. They lived right across the street from Highline High School. And then we kept in touch because Sato didn't break up at that point. And then years later, we started a new band. And Brock suggested Mike, and we started playing together. And even the promoter knew that, everyone knew that Mike was a big focal point, a big draw, and he put his name on the flyer and everything. And then it came time where I suddenly had no place to live. And like a lot of us, we just decided the world owed us as musicians to not work. We had to play music for you. And you had to give us money and food and women. And that's the way it goes. And we all did it. Every single one of us did it. And so, but I had nowhere to go. And since we were playing in a band, Mike said, you can stay with me. What I thought was amazing, you know. And because I wasn't just staying in his mom's place or something, this was actually where he lived with his dad, John, invading in his space, you know. So I went in there, and it was, his bedroom was set up kind of like a tiki Hawaiian joint. And he had all the bases and all these clothes, just massive clothes stacked, and pictures from Atlantic City and his dad with all these movie stars. And then, so he put me on the couch, and I stayed there probably a couple months. And I remember this white drum set being there, and it was Sean's. And he really admired, you know, Sean Kenny, and who was actually going out with Melinda at the time. And he was really, really, really proud of his family. And I just started thinking back about all these years. You know, he never really asked for anything. He always gave. And but a typical day would be, we'd get up, you know, we'd take showers, crank the George Michael or the Motley Crue in the shower so loud so we could hear every word in the shower. Then we'd head down to maybe Dave Jensen's tanning salon and get free shampoo and tan for free, And we'd come back and we'd be all orange. And then Mike, he was getting into his buff stage, so he started working out like crazy, and he was getting really buff, you know, and I wasn't, so they had like paint muscles on me for pictures, but and put me on phone books, and so, but then, you know, we were, management, unfortunately, we listened to our, we had people managing us, and they said, oh, you know, this guitar player isn't good for your Brock, or this, so we unfortunately listened, and so we parted ways, and then we had Frankie Avalon's son, Tony Avalon, and he flew up. And that was really an interesting experience. And he stayed with us there. And Gail was really nice, and she brought all groceries for us and everything and just made us feel great, you know, because here we are homeless people. We're used to just eating, you know, drinking Shasta and bologna sandwiches and, you know, top ramen and, you know, and paying the bills however we can, you know. But she made us feel really at home. I'd met my girlfriend through Mike. We were driving down the street at the time, 1987, it was summer of 1987, and we were driving down and we saw these two chicks and we said, pick them up. We didn't ask, we just said, you're getting in the car with us. And they got in the car, and for the next 6 years, that was my girlfriend, Tanya Braun. And so when it came time for me to leave Mike's place, I ended up moving in with her. And we all developed a friendship over the years. But unfortunately, Tanya lost her life on May 7th. But I moved in with Tanya, and I moved actually between Tanya and Mike Gershman's place, and we had met Jerry, and we always wanted the best players. That was the way it had to be. These guys had to be the top, because we're the best. And Sean just disappeared for some reason. We wasn't quite sure where he was. But we had this drummer, so we said, okay, let's talk to Jerry. And the guy was amazing, you know, he was completely organized. And, you know, Gypsy Rose kicked everybody out of the band one by one, including myself at the end. And I actually got beat up, you know. but the interesting thing, I don't think a lot of people know this, but we actually, the band with those members broke up in, I think it was November of 1987, but here these guys formed, and in 3 months, can you imagine in 3 months writing a whole set of songs, you know, say 10, 12 songs, and playing shows by January of 88, completely like you've been playing for 10 years. I mean, these guys were complete, I mean, it's amazing. They got signed, and they deserved it, and they were amazing. There was a fight over a girl, and that's why he got kicked out of our band, And it's amazing that he still is really hurt over that, because decades later he would bring that up every time I saw him, and I felt really bad. I thought, because all he just wanted was to be loved, you know. Thank you.
Well, this concludes this portion of Mike's memorial. We ran a little over, imagine that. We invite everyone to stick around, grab something to drink, get something to eat if you want. We're going to finish off with some bagpipes, playing Amazing Grace, and then again, a procession with the bagpipe player heading over to the fountain. We encourage everybody to stick around and head that way. So again, on behalf of Mike's family, thank you everyone for coming.
Fourth grade. I'm in fourth grade, Mr. Calloway's class at Boulevard Park Elementary School. Yes. And I'm sitting there, already in class, of course. I think it was, I don't know, September, October that year. And you know, and they knock on the door, and the new student thing comes in. He comes tripping in class with a jeans vest, jeans, and a jean-like cap on from freaking straight from Jackson 5. And he's in fourth grade. I knew he was, I walked in, he's like, eh.
That guy's a pimp.
Who's a rock star already at 10? 10 years old.
Hey.
Your girlfriends worry about the fact that two people can fit in these bunks?
Two men, yeah.
Mike Starr from Alice in Chains is listening to KUGR 95 Rock.
Say goodbye, don't follow.
Wait, cut, I'm in my underwear. What's going on here, huh?
I don't know. All right, thanks.
Thank you.